Good evening and Happy New Year to all, and welcome to the January 12, 2009 meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council. I would ask the clerk to please read the roll.
Chairman Rowe.
Here.
Councilor Backer.
Here.
Councilor Lennon.
Here.
Councilor McKinney.
Here.
Councilor Sherman.
Here.
Councilor Swift Kayata.
Here.
Would you please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance to our flag?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Town Council reports and correspondence. I have just a couple items I'd like to introduce tonight. While I had chaired one meeting of the Town Council last year as an interim, last month's Town Council meeting was actually my first as a bona fide chairman, duly elected on my own right. And I'll confess to you that I was a little distracted at that meeting last month due to a loss in my family just the day before. Over the ensuing days and weeks, though, I have the amount of outpouring of support that I and my family have received from many, many people has just been nothing short of overwhelming, and much of that support has come from the town of Cape Elizabeth. And I'm most grateful to all of you. Thank you, and I convey the thanks of my family from the bottom of my heart. 2008 was another year in which we sadly felt the passing of several notable Cape Elizabeth citizens. Unfortunately, we did not finish the remaining days of December, though since our last meeting, without the loss of yet another. And I refer here to Lewis Winnick, patriarch of his family and father of Alice Laria, who donated to the town the 70 acres plus or minus of land that we now call Winnick Woods. Winnick Woods has become a living memorial, if you will, to the Winnick family's strong interest in conservation and to its love of animals of all kinds. I had the pleasure of meeting Lou at the dedication of the Winnick Woods trail system in September. He was 95 years old when he passed away, and he will be missed. Other reports and correspondence? Ann?
I just wanted to mention, as this year's finance chair for the town council, I wanted to make everyone in the town aware that we are having, it's budget season. Budget season is starting, and we are having a public input session, a public forum for sponsored by both the town council and the school board, for the town council and school board members to hear from the citizens of Cape Elizabeth. That public forum will be here in the town council chambers at 7 p.m. on Wednesday, January 21st, and it will be an opportunity for citizens to come and tell us anything they want that's budget related about both the municipal budget, the school budget, the county budget, and the community services budget. We are starting our planning process, but we're particularly interested in any, this is a very difficult year economically. I think people are pretty aware that the national economy and the local economy is somewhat shaky at the moment, and so we are facing a great many challenges budget-wise as people are in their own homes and in their own lives. And so we are particularly interested in hearing input from citizens on any revenue enhancements or suggestions they have for things that we should be charging more for, and as a way to increase municipal revenues. We're interested in hearing your priorities for services that you feel are important or not so important if we do have to make service cuts or programmatic cuts on both the municipal and school sides. We're interested in that. And we're also lastly interested in what you feel is the proper level of property tax that you should be paying. So thank you. We really encourage people to come and tell us what you think, because we listen carefully to citizens' priorities when we make decisions about the budget. Thank you.
Thank you, Ann. Other reports and correspondence from the council? David?
Oh, no.
Okay. Okay. Offensive, David. Okay. I would now offer our first dose of citizen opportunity for discussion of items not on tonight's agenda. Citizens that would like to speak on any item that is not on tonight's agenda? Seeing none, Town Manager's report.
Yes, thank you, Jim. I wanted to mention a couple of things. First of all, there's always a lot of emails going back and forth on a whole lot of issues, and I'd like to particularly relate one email that I had a chance to read today that actually went to Bob Malley. And let me, I don't usually read things aloud, but I really like this one. It was dated today, to whom it may concern. I am writing to express my thanks to the person who was on snowplow duty during yesterday's snowstorm. We live on the cul-de-sac at, I won't mention the street because it involves some kids. This individual, meaning the snowplow operator, actually took the time to move my son's toys that had been left on top of our snowbank before he plowed them over during the plow turnaround in front of our house. The trucks were safely waiting for us along our front walk when we went out later in the day. My husband and I were so impressed at this attention to detail. We are new Cape Elizabeth residents and cannot believe how responsive everyone at Public Works has been to our questions as we have gotten settled. Please pass this note on to the person who did our street plowing. He or she deserves to know their kind gesture did not go unnoticed. Keep up the good work. This is a resident on the North Shore of Cape Elizabeth, but, and Ron O'Brien, who's the equipment operator on our part, and who's also the captain of the volunteer captain of Engine One Company, was the operator. And I think, you know, this is the service that's provided. And I mentioned to Bob, I called him this morning. I was at the airport last night and was driving home a little after 11. And I'm always careful not to compare us, and Bob knows it's a pet peeve of mine, to other communities because there are all sorts of other circumstances. But even the tarmac at the airport was covered with snow. Drove, you know, through the roads in Portland, Congress Street, some of those areas, came up St. John Street. And everything was slippery, drove into South Portland, it was quite a bit better. And then I drove into Cape Elizabeth. And, you know, they always do an outstanding job. It was particularly noted then when I didn't really expect to see new snow coming in. But between, you know, this email and seeing that last night, it really made me feel good about what those folks do. And, you know, and I think often it's forgotten. It's not taken note of. Secondly, you know, the council received at least, there were notes of a phone call and at least another email about the dispatchers. And, you know, as difficult as it is recommending that we consolidate that, nonetheless, it is still very good to read the appreciation that folks have for the individuals who are in those positions. And, you know, it even makes it, you know, tougher to be contemplating decisions like that when you read those notes in the email. So those are very much appreciated. And, you know, on that note, just to update you on that, as we're continuing to have discussions with other communities. Today I had a discussion with the fire chief from the city of Portland. Portland and South Portland's looking at consolidating their dispatching fully. And, you know, we're very interested in having Cape Elizabeth along with that. So we are considering looking at that and look forward to hearing other thoughts and opinions on that in the months ahead. So thank you, Jim.
Thank you, Mike. And echo his words on our town employees. Great job. We had tentatively scheduled a presentation for tonight from the Cool Cape folks, but they have asked that they be put on February's agenda, so we will honor that request.
Excuse me, from the who? From
the Cool Cape.
Oh, Cool Cape.
Cool Cape, I'm sorry.
Thank you.
Yep. So we'll be hearing from those folks in February. And the next item, the review of the minutes of the meeting held on December 8th, did not make it into our packets this evening. They were done, but due to a medical emergency, the minutes did not make it from here to here, and that's why they weren't in our packets. So we will defer consideration of those until next month. The first real media item on our agenda is a public hearing regarding recycling center hours. It pertains to the following item, 28-2009. We're proposing to change the recycling center hours. It's recommended to change the hours of the recycling center effective February 1st, 2009 to Monday, 10 a.m. to 7 p.m., Wednesday, Friday, and Saturday from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m., Sunday, Tuesday, and Thursday, the recycling center would be closed. So I would entertain a motion to open public hearing, or can I just open the public hearing? I will just open the public hearing. I declare the public hearing on the recycling hours, proposed recycling hours, open. Any citizen who would like to speak to that item may approach the lectern. Seeing none, I would close the public hearing. And we will now consider item number 28-2009. Do I have a motion, or would we like, David?
I move that we change the hours of the recycling center effective February 1, 2009 to eliminate 2 hours on Wednesday evening and to eliminate 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. on Thursdays, which would leave the center open on Mondays from 10 a.m. to 7 p.m. And open on Wednesdays, Fridays, and Saturdays from 8 a.m. until 5 p.m.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Do we have discussion on the motion? This the whole impetus behind this is purely economic. We're trying to save money by compressing the hours into and thereby creating savings from not having the recycling center manned and operated. Any other comments? All in favor of the motion? Show it to be unanimous, please. Item 29-2009, we have a rezoning request. Jane Waning Nicholas has formally requested the rezoning of number 551 Shore Road, currently BA zoned. She would like it changed to become a residential property. The zoning ordinance requires that this item be referred to the planning board. I don't see Ms. Nicholas here tonight to speak on it, so I would entertain a motion.
Well, I had some questions. Do you want to have the motion first? Or?
We can have the motion, then we can discuss.
Okay.
Do I have a motion? David?
I move that we refer to the planning board the request of Jane Nicholas to rezone her property at 551 Shore Road from the BA zone to a residential zone.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion on the motion. David.
The planning board has already taken up the issue of the boundary lines of the BA districts in connection with the potential rezoning of 553 Shore Road. This property is adjacent to that particular parcel, and it seems to me that the arguments for or against rezoning would be virtually identical as to what we've already been grappling with, both during the planning board process as well as now in the ordinance committee, and then ultimately back before the town council when we schedule a public hearing on the 553 Shore Road issue. So I'm wondering whether it is necessary to put the planning board to the task of essentially dealing with the same issue with respect to Ms. Nicholas's property. It seems to me if there was any way to combine consideration of her request with what we're already dealing with in the ordinance committee, that would seem to be a bit more expeditious. So that's the first issue I throw out there, and it may be a question for the town manager. He may want to weigh in on that.
Hey, David? Mike?
I will. Maureen O'Meara and I both met with Ms. Nicholas and suggested that very opportunity, indicating that it was before the ordinance committee. They'd probably be discussing it anyway, since this lot's in the middle, and, you know, said we really don't know what they're doing with the other lot, but it's, you know, it'll be considered. And, you know, she went back and forth, but in the end, as you can see from the trail of letters, she confirmed that she did in fact want to go through this process. And under the amendment provisions of the zoning ordinance, particularly the how to amend the zoning map, it does, if you are petitioned, the zoning ordinance does specifically require that it be referred to the planning board. That is not to say that the ordinance committee couldn't still make a recommendation to the town council and act on it without the planning board recommendation, and then the planning board could act on it with dispatch at that point. But as far as, you know, Ms. Nicholas did formally wish it to be referred and to go through the process from the start, even though she was advised that it was probably a much better way to do it.
During my stint on the planning board, I do recall being sometimes questioning why something came to us, and it appears that there's no discretion from the town council to do that, but unless I hear something remarkably different from the information I've already heard, I would just want this applicant to know that I would not be inclined to support the rezoning. I'm also concerned in her own interest here, and I know obviously I'll wait and hear what everyone has to say before I make a final decision, but right now she is using the property for a three-unit residential apartment building, essentially, which is a conforming use in the BA district. If her efforts are successful and her property is rezoned, she'll have a non-conforming use of the existing property, which seems contrary to her interest. She also, I think, has to pay an application fee of $100. Also, if the property is rezoned, she is constricting the potential uses of it for the future, and in my view, reducing the potential value of the property, though I guess that's open to debate. But I'm just concerned, and maybe I'm being paternalistic here, that this applicant is pursuing an application that frankly just makes no sense for her. With all that in mind, I'll certainly support the motion. I just hope that the planning board doesn't, well, I don't know if anybody else wants to weigh in, but it seems like we're sort of asking them to do the same thing they've already done, and I hate to see a volunteer board go through that.
Thank you, David. Other comments? Discussion on the motion? Seeing none, all in favor of the motion? Show it to be unanimous, please. Item number 30-2009, school budget curtailment. Would you like to speak to this, Ann, or Mike?
Sure, I can make a motion, and then
sure.
Mike can chime in or whatever. And the reason I'm speaking is because I'm finance chair this year. The town council requested that this be put on this agenda at our December meeting. It was requested because, as the public may or may not know, this fiscal year 2008-2009, the year we're currently in, for the school system receives state aid for education, commonly known as general purpose aid, GPA, and that amount, due to problems in the state budget, has been curtailed by the governor's mandate. And the final amount is not known, but the estimate, it won't be known until probably later this month, or perhaps at the latest by mid-February, when the legislature figures out exactly what they want to do. But the amount that we're currently thinking will be curtailed from the Cape Elizabeth school system is $421,000 approximately. That is state aid for education, a revenue that was built into the fiscal year 2009 budget. And it's what the tax rate and the school budgets were built upon. And so now they're going to be in the hole because it's $421,000 that they are not going to receive in this year. It's already more than halfway through that fiscal year. So at this point, it is quite difficult for them to make substantial changes in the way their classes are set up. If you cut personnel, for instance, you cut the number of teachers, you might have to change classes all around. Anyways, it's a challenge. So the town, the municipal side of the town, looked at what we could do, remembering the one town concept, which is a concept where we try to work together with the schools and the municipal budgets and staffs to be more efficient and effective in working, and thus to be more efficient and effective in and low in the taxes we have to charge people. Keeping that in mind, the council had discussions at a finance committee meeting at our town council workshop last week on January 6th, and the finance committee, voting as the finance committee, not as the council, voted 3-1 at that meeting last week to recommend the following action to the town council tonight. And I'll make this in the form of a motion. to authorize a transfer of up to $200,000 from the town undesignated surplus to the school undesignated surplus. However, the transferred amount will not be more than 50% of the amount of the GPA curtailment amount for school year 2008-2009. And that last part of there is in there so that if the curtailment amount turns out to be less than the $421,000, we would adjust accordingly. But that's the motion. And that's what the Finance Committee voted 3-1 to present to the whole town council.
I second the motion.
Moved and seconded. Discussion on the motion.
And I might add that Mike McGovern may want to add facts and figures about the undesignated surplus if anybody has questions about that.
David?
And then Sarah. My discussion is more in the nature of a question, and it may be that Councilor Swift-Kayata will be able to weigh in. With regard to the portion of the motion that limits the transfer of funds to the, it's the greater of, well,
it's a maximum of $200,000.
The lesser of 50% or $200,000.
Yes.
When will we know what the final curtailment is, and is the transfer of funds to take place only after that final curtailment is determined?
I can answer part of that. As for when we will know, it's when the legislature gets themselves together and deals with it, which we estimate will be, I have heard at Maine Municipal Association, I have heard by the end of January. I've quizzed last week when we met with our, when we, the council met at our workshop with our three legislators, and Larry Bliss mentioned as late as the second week in February. So I hope that we will know the exact number of the curtailment by the, at the latest, the second week in February. In terms of the transfer, I don't think the transfer would take place until we know exactly what the number is going to be. Michael, do you want to talk about the mechanics?
Just on that point, the school department is currently planning for a curtailment of the $421,000. This motion is drafted by the Finance Committee, takes care of $200,000 for any curtailment over $400,000. If the curtailment is less than $400,000 and less is transferred, the school budget reduction will actually need to be less as well. So, you know, the school department won't, you know, doesn't need to have to do any additional planning beyond what they're already doing for the $421,000. Unless, of course, if the curtailment was more than that, then, you know, it's still, then the $200,000 cap remains. But the actual transfer just will probably not take place until we actually know the curtailment. But regardless, the school department, once this motion passed, would plan on that effectively taking place just as soon as their curtailment's known.
And if I may, Mr. Chairman, I would add that I'm supporting this. I tend to be a person who believes in fiscal restraint, but I would add that I am supporting this motion because I think that this is halfway or a little more than halfway through a fiscal year. And I think it is a true urgent need of the school department. I am not in favor on a general basis, and this was expressed at the workshop at the Finance Committee meeting last week. On a general basis, I don't think we should be using undesignated surplus to fund operating expenses. However, I think this is a very unusual circumstance, and it was very made very clear in the meeting last week at which the majority of school board members attended too, that this was not a general principle, that we would not be planning to, that no one should be planning to dip into undesignated surplus every year to try and make up operating expenses. And that the, if the curtailment becomes sort of a permanent curtailment for the fiscal 10 budget and on, that then they would have adequate time to do planning, to figure out their revenues and expenditures, and to make adjustments as necessary without having to create quite a ruckus in the school system with the children by making significant changes partway through the school year. So that's one reason I'm supporting it.
Sarah, you had your hand up before.
I apologize because I had to leave the Finance Committee meeting early, so I may be asking for somebody to repeat what you've already discussed, but if somebody could just very briefly explain the rationale behind this last clause that says the transfer amount will not be more than 50% of the GPA curtailment. Just not surprisingly, knowing my bias, I'm curious why, if we're prepared and willing to give this goal $200,000, why if the curtailment were less than that, we wouldn't still be willing to give them $200,000 given the state of crisis that the schools are currently in.
Ann, would you like to speak to that?
Well, I can address it somewhat, but everybody has different points of view. I would say having that I have attended the school board workshops, budget workshops so far, and they already have plans for how they're going to deal with this. They were hoping for $200,000. They have a $70,000 contingency account for emergencies. So $70,000 right there could be used. This is what I heard in their discussion. I don't speak for them because it's up to them how they choose to meet their financial obligations. But $70,000 right there could be. And they had plans for other things that they could do. I think they were very appreciative, and they expressed to me they were very appreciative for the town offering to pick up the town side of the overall town, the municipal side of the town, offering to share the pain, so to speak. So.
And if I could have one word.
Sure.
One reason why we don't allow the designated fund balance to become too low is that if you let it get below 1/12 of your expenditures or 1 month ahead of your expenditures, it begins to affect your bond rating and your ability to borrow money. And as we've all found out as communities, not just Cape Elizabeth, borrowing becomes more and more a part of making ends meet, unfortunately. I think it is unfortunate that we have to put ourselves in that position, but it's the reality of the day and the way things operate now, that's one reason for preserving our designated fund balance. David.
I'm just wondering if I could get an explanation, and I may have heard it the other night, but it was kind of late. But the $200,000 figure that the town manager had originally recommended, was that based on the overall town surplus, and therefore that number was considered to be okay, and that if the town actually did transfer that sum to the school, we would not be violating or contravening the policy of 1 month's worth of operating budget?
The $200,000 was arrived at with some degree of risk assessment because it does, in fact, bring us down below the recommended level. But, I remember having discussions back and forth with some on it that, if you never brought it below the recommended level, what's the purpose of having it? So it was a risk assessment as in terms of how much it should be allowed to go below that level. And the sense is, particularly with these economic times, just in the last 2 months, we've foreclosed on two homes for non-payment of taxes, and one non-payment of sewer and one non-payment of taxes. And, there could be more of that coming, and there's a sense that if there's a time to preserve cash flow and to preserve some equity, that this is probably the time to do it and not to get too extravagant and exposing too much of our cash flow and too much of our undesignated fund balance.
Ann?
Just to add, for the benefit of citizens who may be listening or watching on television who may not be aware, as they probably shouldn't be aware, of what the undesignated surplus is all about, it is akin to the working capital of a private sector firm. In other words, the town gets its major revenues, its tax, property tax revenues, in twice a year when we do tax collections in October and in April. And so we have a whole bunch of cash come in then, and then we sort of work it down, but we have to pay expenses 12 months of the year. We have to pay the teachers, we have to pay the plow operators, we have to pay the librarians, we have to pay everybody, and we have to run all the things that we do in the town, the library, the schools, the fire department, the police department, so on and so forth. And so it is fiscally prudent. That's why we have this policy of with regard to the fund balance, of the undesignated fund balance, that we try to maintain it in 1/12, which is 8.1 or 8.33%, 8.33% we try to maintain it at that level of our annual operating expenses, so that if a catastrophe does strike, or if the economy goes into a serious decline, which it may well be doing, and then perhaps people don't pay taxes to the high, we collect taxes now at a very high level, it's like 99.7% of people pay their taxes on time, something like that. Well, if it goes down 0.2%, that's almost $500,000. And given what's going on in the economy, I believe it's fiscally prudent to help the schools, but also not to do more than what we've suggested with this motion, because we may well need it for much more dire circumstances next year. If our tax collections go down even a couple tenths of a percent, we may have some other need for it. So.
David? I was the one member of the Finance Committee to vote against the motion, and my only objection to it was the clause that followed the initial proposal to take $200,000 or transfer that sum to the school side of the ledger, if you will. It seems to me unlikely, based on what I'm hearing, that the curtailment is going to be anything less than $421,000, so this may all be academic anyway. Obviously, I hope it is less than that amount. For the benefit of our town, but it seems to me if the town council is prepared to take $200,000 from the undesignated surplus, and provided that the curtailment is $200,000 or more, we ought to just be prepared to transfer the $200,000. I've advocated for that position. There were three members of the Finance Committee who disagree with me, but I would advocate that position again tonight.
Thanks, Dave. David Becker.
I understand over the last several years of being on the council, the reasons why we've created the policy that we have for maintaining the undesignated surplus. And I firmly believe that it's a policy that was well thought out at the time we created it, and it remains that way. But I also well understand what, as Anne described, sort of the extraordinary circumstances that we're facing with the curtailment that has happened mid-year without any advance notice, and the importance of stepping in to help the school side of the budget. But I think that the maximum, the 50% maximum portion of this is a reasonable compromise of how to weigh the two sides of competing issues. And I will support the motion because although it may be imperfect on either side, I think it's a reasonable midpoint.
Thank you. Other comments? I too will be supporting the motion for the reasons mentioned already. Other comments, questions, discussion? Seeing none. All in favor of Ann's motion? Opposed? Show the vote to be 4-2.
I just hope the record is clear that I support the first part of the motion. I'm not voting against the concept. Thank you.
Ditto.
Item 31-2009, bond issue update. I would once again call on our Finance Committee Chair to review where the Finance Committee meeting took us the other night in discussions, and then I think the manager would also like to speak to this issue as well.
Well, I would just give a brief introduction that, as we know, last year there was a bond that the council passed, and that bond had certain proceeds. It was planned for certain amounts, which were laid out at that time. And some of that money has been expended. There was a memo from the manager at our workshop last week that laid out his recommendations for the the allocation of the bond proceeds remaining as of December 31st, 2008. And so I would turn it over to Mike McGovern, the manager, to talk about what his recommendations are.
I would too.
Oh, and I would say that the Finance Committee last week voted 4-0 to support the recommendations laid out in his memo last week.
Yeah, I apologize for not, I won't be as brief as Ann just was, but anyway, I'll try to move it along real quick. This particular bond issue really came about during the winter and spring of 2007, now about 2 years ago. And what happened was there were a number of different projects that were coming forward to the town all at the same time that were things that would benefit the citizens on a long-term basis, and all of which would be too much to fund in any 1 year. And when you're in those types of situations, and when you have other debt being retired, that's the time that you generally look at borrowing money. And so it appeared to be at that time the perfect opportunity to take care of the different issues. And I'd like to briefly go over, you know, at that time the council authorized, and I believe the vote was unanimous, $1.25 million for town center improvements. One was the traffic light at the high school entrance. That came about after a couple of different studies, after, just like today, the council had been bombarded with earlier emails with people demanding action at the high school intersection because of all the traffic that used to back up out of there. It also was a requirement of the planning board when the high school was approved, the renovation of the high school back a few years ago, but the school building committee did not allocate any money for it, so that was one project that's now complete. Secondly was town center stormwalk and sidewalk improvements. This all grew out of the August 1993 town center plan that was a citizen committee, and they recommended that there be a stormwater management plan done, and that was done in March of 1995. So here it is, you know, 14, 15 years later, and, you know, that's how long it takes to accomplish some of this stuff. About 25% of it was done back then, but then, you know, actually the school projects all came up, particularly the high school project, and it was delayed because of that. It wasn't done at the time. The borrowing went to the high school instead. There was $660,000 part of the bond issue for the Spurwink Meeting House, and again, there was a July 2006 report of a citizen committee, fairly thick. You know, these, sometimes people think, you know, we just pull these things out of air, and, you know, in fact, you know, most of these are citizen committee driven, and, you know, there's a background to all of it. But they looked at the church, they looked at the structure. The church was built in 1834, beginning in 1802, but most of it was built in 1834. The structural aspects of the church are now exactly 175 years old, and nothing's been done in 175 years. This report identified the need to deal with that structure, and it was felt that because there isn't an attachment of individuals to the church, and actually a plan of the Comprehensive Planning Survey showed that, it was decided that instead of having another fundraising campaign, like so many other things, the town would borrow the money and would get the project done. There was fencing for Hannaford Field, which the school department, Keith Weatherby, the then athletic director, had requested. There were greenbelt improvements, and again, there was a citizen committee in 1977 that recommended certain aspects of the greenbelt. The Conservation Commission did a report in 1988. The Conservation Commission did a report in 2001. And, you know, some of it got done, and they're finding that in some of the areas, it's necessary to actually have boardwalks. A lot of that was put in, a lot of the work's now done. It was suggested, let's ask the school department what their needs are. And the school board weighed in and said, we'd like $150,000 for safety and security items, we'd like $186,000 for classroom furniture, and we'd like $125,200 for miscellaneous building school building and repair. They asked for a couple of other minor things that were real operating costs that weren't bondable. The council agreed to all that. That was included as part of the bond. Subsequently, there were some citizens who had raised a lot of money for the Hannaford Field and wanted to raise money for bleachers, but the fundraising capacity was beginning to run out at that point because of they had raised about $1 million. And the town council eventually, with a recommendation from the school board, added that $150,000 to the bond. So that's the genesis of the bond. It all comes out of citizen committees. It, you know, it's not something that we just, you know, I sit in my office and dream up what Bob does over at the Public Works Garage or any of the other people involved. They're really citizen-driven. Anyway, so then what happened was some of the bond work was done, but then the Maine Department of Transportation was looking at the Town Center intersection, of which $100,000 of the bond was originally set aside for. The MDOT was very slow in the design, and we were going on with the Town Center, the sidewalk and drainage work, but then we were a little worried about what this intersection was going to cost, so we held off on everything else until we knew what the intersection was going to cost. Ultimately, MDOT went out and got an estimate right at the peak of the market. They did their engineer's estimate at the very worst time that you could have, although no money was being spent, but obviously what would have been the peak expense. Portland, I mentioned to Bob today, just put out some work last week that they had a $5 million engineer's estimates for some combined sewer overflow work that came in at $3.1 million. It tells you a little bit the way the market's changed and why this is a good time to do things like the church and other things. But anyway, that's about where that all stands. Well, anyway, looking at, you know, where it stands now, the Town Center intersection project the council dealt with, it was a council, again, that grew out of a council goal. It was, you know, one of the things that was on the council goal list for a couple of years. But anyway, some citizens weren't really appreciative of the proposed recommendations. The citizens let themselves be heard. The council put it off until May, but in the meantime asked for me to present some alternatives, which we've done both small scale and continuing to look at some of the large scale issues. Anyway, the Finance Committee met last Thursday. They looked at different suggestions, and they came forward with a 4-0 recommendation. Since then, there's been a couple of emails. There's also been, I spoke with Ann a couple of times today, I think Jim once or twice, about, you know, I said, where do you think the council really stands on this? And, you know, while there seemed to be probably 4 votes to go ahead with the Town Center stormwater and drainage, you know, based on what councilors had said the other night, you know, there just didn't seem to be, yeah, let's do this. I just didn't sense, you know, even if there'd be a majority, that it was a majority that was roaring and ready to go in this thing. Anyway, so it forced me to sit down this afternoon, and I've got a sheet here that's in front of you, and I put some out back, and looking at what I'm calling bond principles, and this is LE, not the principle of the money, and recommendations. And then also looking at some particular road maintenance. It should be in front of all of you somewhere. It was placed at your places tonight. Anyway, the overall guiding forces, I think, for bond issues should be that projects once bonded should be completed unless extenuating circumstances dictate. You know, once you do a bond, we ought to, you know, to be credible to do bonds, we really should be sticking with what they're originally for, unless extenuating circumstances dictate. But two, if a change is necessary, it should adhere as much as possible to the original purposes. Three, I think it's unwise to change priorities on approved bonds as new council members are elected. Usually bonds get done pretty quick, but this case, because of all these balls up in the air, they didn't. But, you know, what happens is, for example, the town's intersection, MDOT spent $116,000 on design. Bob and I and others, Maureen, you know, have spent hundreds of hours on implementing that project. And, you know, it unless, you know, there's a real strong need to change something, it generally shouldn't be done. So, because of the investment we make in them. The Town Center stormwater stuff we've spent about $30,000 on. Fourth, bond proceeds should not be utilized to balance operating budgets. And these are principles which I think should apply to any bond. But then we are in different times, so I'm trying to come up with some principles for this particular bond, because I think any decision should be based on certain principles. First, I think we need to recognize that we have the worst economy by many standards since the Great Depression. So there are some extenuating circumstances. Second, bond proceeds should not be used to substitute for an expense already in an operating budget. you know, it's you know, they should be used for capital purposes. Third, priority should be given to funding needs for existing infrastructure and not for new infrastructure that is desired. Four, priority should be given for spending funds in areas that you can take advantage of lower costs now, and which, if not done now, would result in much higher costs in the future. So my specific recommendation at this point is different from the one that the Finance Committee came up with the other night. First is to take advantage of the current bidding climate and to repair the Spurwing Church with a total project cost of approximately $425,000. This is, some money's been spent, there's $397,000 still to be spent out of that approximate budget, but project cost of approximately $425,000. Two, continue to give the school board full flexibility for directing the $73,821 in remaining funds in the school allocation, the amounts that they haven't spent out of those amounts I earlier indicated. Three, we need to pay the retainage on the bleacher project, the money that we owe still to the contractor. Four, we ought to pay whatever obligations we've made for the remaining $15,000 in the Greenbelt portion of the bond, but with the remaining $15,000, do not commit to any other Greenbelt projects with the bond proceeds. Five, and I'll go into this a little bit in a minute, spend up to $500,000 for maintaining road and parking lot infrastructure. And six, the balance of approximately $300,000 should be frozen and used for capital purposes that I would later recommend and that would later need to be approved by the town council. This would allow, you know, the alternative energy recommendations to be considered. It would allow, you know, a whole host of recommendations come forward from wherever. You know, there's recommendations, but we try to channel those monies to purposes that generally meet the other principles and that, you know, that take care, you know, that when I say that, really focused on maintaining existing infrastructure. The second sheet that is along with this is we looked and, you know, to sort of defend the $500,000 recommendation for taking some of the original town center money and to spend on maintaining the roads. We have about 60 to 61 miles of roads in Cape Elizabeth. The cost to take care of roads has been going up nationwide. Some of you may have recently seen a report from the Maine Turnpike Authority in terms of, I think everyone knows paving those costs. Anyway, if we went out and paved all our roads, it'd be a little over $6 million. The annual cost, if you look at the life cycle, is $410,000 that we should be spending a year to maintain roads. If you look at what we also should be spending for sidewalks, for drainage, and for the heavier duty reconstruction that needs to be done, it's about $700,000 a year. We're budgeting $225,000 a year, so we're falling short on an annualized basis currently just to maintain our existing road network and so a little bit of drainage work and a little bit of sidewalk work, about $480,000 a year. The real problem with roads is if you don't catch them at the right time, you end up, I call it, with a Spurwink Avenue on your hands. The road gets so bad and you end up spending three times 5 years later what you could have spent in the initial year. And the areas that are particularly in the greatest need right now are Route 77, the strip, and out beyond by the Beach to Beacon start line. You can look at those shoulders, how much that's falling apart. It's portions of Sawyer Road, beginning around the area near Stillman, and then, you know, all along the section by the Rod Gun Club is really starting to deteriorate. And, you know, if you look at, you know, just Route 77 alone would cost over $1 million if we were to put a simple paving on all of it. We would be doing that. We'd only be doing part of it because this end here doesn't need to be done. But, you know, if we don't invest in those roads, then we are going to be spending a lot more in the future. So I think it's a, you know, which then if we have to spend more in the future, that's money that's not going to be available for the other things that the community needs to do at that time or wants to do at that time. So that's where I come forward with these recommendations, where the principles they're based on. And, you know, what I've tried to do is to listen to the various concerns, listen to the levels of enthusiasm, be respectful of the original purposes of the bond, but also respect the fact that we are in different circumstances today. So Thank you for that lengthy, allowing me to do that lengthy explanation.
Thank you, Mike. Before the council goes into discussion on this, I know we had at least one citizen who wanted to speak to this issue tonight, and I would ask her to come forward and also anyone else who would like to speak to this.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council. I appreciate the opportunity to speak to you. I drove through the intersection of Shore and Route 77 on Friday afternoon, and it was a mess. And I thought to myself, well, I know the council has put this aside, but they won't make a decision until May, and perhaps some or all of them will drive through this intersection and see what a mess it is. Well, I got home and opened up my Sentry and read that, in fact, you were proposing to kill the traffic light. And so I appreciate very much the opportunity to speak to you tonight. The need for this project has been documented for almost 20 years. I won't go through all the reports. You all have them. You all have seen them. The intersection has been and remains an F for anyone trying to make a left-hand turn off of Shore Road or Scott Dyer. This is a failing grade by every traffic engineer who has studied this intersection for close to 20 years. The council has worked on this project for 6 years, as has had staff and public citizen committees. The need has not gone away. The pedestrian crossing improvements, while much appreciated, are a band-aid and do nothing to improve the level of service F. Those are strictly pedestrian improvements. I understand that times are hard and you need to make difficult economic choices, but canceling the traffic light, as at least was proposed in the agenda, and I appreciate the town manager's comments tonight, will save no money, because what you were proposing to do was to use the money bonded for one purpose to use and spend for another purpose today. Some might call that bait and switch, but at a minimum, it's bad government and bad public policy. You are killing a safety project supported by multiple engineering studies for some nice-to-do improvements. Traffic lights are never popular. In 1992, the then town council approved and installed the light at Spurwink and 77 over much popular objection. And I know those of you who've lived in Cape Elizabeth as long or longer than me will remember that popular objection. Likewise, many argued that the traffic light at the high school was not needed, again, despite substantial engineering studies which supported the need. A traffic light which improves safety will never win a popularity contest, as one of my fellow councilors pointed out on several occasions. Currently, as the town manager has suggested, there is a very favorable competitive bidding climate, and I urge you to put the light out to bid and to get complete financial information before you turn this money back to the state. And I also urge you to take the prudent course and address the safety issue before someone is seriously hurt. Again, I thank you very much for your time and your service to the people of Cape Elizabeth.
Thank you, Marianne. Are there other citizens who would like to speak to this?
Much experience in this issue, but it seems like it's a lot of money for a high school parking lot, and coming from...
Excuse me, I didn't ask this of the last speaker, but could you please introduce yourself?
Oh, Rick Fontana.
Yeah, and your address. And your address, please.
14 Valley Road.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks. Just seems like it's a lot of money to spend on a parking lot that could just as well be gravel or something. And as a member of the Alternative Energy Committee, it's been a concern that people are, I forgot what they call the bus, loser cruiser, something like that, but it's not advantageous from an energy point of view for kids to drive to school. I don't see why it should be that nice a parking lot. If it's kind of gravelly and muddy, it might not be a bad thing to make it more of a, how'd you get so dirty? Oh, I drove today. So just a different slant on where to spend our money. Thanks.
Thank you.
I apologize. I didn't specifically address the parking lot issue when I mentioned the paving. If you look at these cost estimates, this doesn't include our responsibility for, you know, when I look at our annual, that we also take care of a bunch of parking lots in the community. But the These parking lots, the one in back of the back of the high school was last paved in 1969. The lower one by the track was got its binder surface, never received its top surface, so it's without having ever had that, it's liable to failure. If you look going down the high school driveway to the back, you're starting to see potholes, you're starting to see major deterioration there. The parking lot that goes down towards the Weatherby track and field, also, if you've driven, I don't know, how many of you have driven down there lately? Any of the citizens? Maybe not, but it's rapidly deteriorating. It's beginning to get washed away by the lack of the crown, the lack of the proper drainage there. And, you know, I don't know, you said it was too much, and...
I don't know what it is.
Yeah.
I like having good roads, but there's a big lot there that seems to be in good enough shape, you know, the one closer to the 77. It's kind of rough, but I guess the roads, I think we should keep well maintained. The parking lots, depends where they are. The teacher lots should be good, the student lots.
I just wanted to explain a little bit more since I didn't specifically mention parking.
Thank you, Mike.
Thank you.
Robert Barton, 8 Woods Knoll Drive. I just wanted to ask a little bit, understand a little bit better the sidewalk project between the traffic light and going down to Fowler Road. And I was getting a little bit confused between there's general sidewalk categories and there's drainage categories. And then in the information, Michael, that you passed out at the last council meeting, it looks like sidewalk replacements and additions, $363,000. Is that the value of that section, including the drainage for it?
Yeah, the latest engineer's estimate was for significant drainage works and for a treatment of the sidewalk from the high school entrance to Fowler Road, similar to the sidewalks that are in the balance of the town center, according to the town center design standards. In the proposal I'm making this evening, there is no funding for that project at all.
Okay. But that would have been part of what was anticipated in the bond issue, right? The 2007 bond issue?
That's correct.
It had been anticipated, but now it's not included in what you're recommending?
And it's not included in what I am recommending this evening.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. Other citizens who would like to speak to this issue? If not, I'll close the citizen comment, and we can debate this as a council. Dave?
I'm just trying to compare what we voted on as a finance committee versus what Mike is recommending, and it seems to me he's done a very good job of responding to some of the concerns that were raised in the interim. But for example, I look at the Spurwing Church recommendation, which personally I don't take issue with, but tonight the cost is approximately $425,000, and then a week ago it was $397,000. So I wonder it might be helpful just to address these one at a time.
That'd be fine.
So we know what we're comparing.
You want me to do that one?
Sure.
Yeah, it was $425,000 last week, it's $425,000 this week. The difference is that the amount in the agenda is the balance of the money still to be spent, but the total project cost remains $425,000. We've already spent money on architects and engineers.
Okay, well, thank you for clearing that up. And I suppose I didn't focus on the issue of the Town Center intersection project closeout the way that we've heard from one member of the public. Is there any need to do that tonight?
No, that would have to come out of the $300,000 that would be frozen at the time when you'd make that resolution. You know, you could make that tonight, and you know, and one reason why, you know, there's a little bit of hesitation for me to drop it is, you know, we never know that MDOT could decide to step in and have more money and whatever, and while I'm not pushing that, I haven't suggested that, you know, I know that project has its lack of supporters. You know, it may be premature to totally kill it since you did table it till May.
And is the $38,000 though part of the new recommendation?
No, there's no proposal to commit any monies at all for that. But it would have to be still hung in the back there, knowing that we probably would need to come up with the closeout money to compete as part of that $300,000.
And I just will keep going unless somebody has another question about that very issue. The hardest thing I'm having a hard time comparing is the $500,000 in item 5 of your recommendation this evening for maintaining road and parking lot infrastructure. What is captured in the old recommendation? Because there's the parking lot and Route 77 paving, which was $410,000 in the recommendation we voted on last week. And I'm trying to figure out what gets added in to get the $500,000.
Before, what that was the balancing number after everything else was done. And the balancing was the $421,000. The reason the $500,000 is, you know, it's the revised recommendation to do away with the sidewalk and drainage thing. But particularly when I updated with Bob the sheet that really looks at what we ought to be spending, $480,000 a year, and to see how much we're consistently failing to do that, it's my sense that it clearly meets the objective of maintaining existing infrastructure, and it very clearly meets even more so that concern that I have that if we don't begin to address some of these things, the costs are going to increase exponentially. And, you know, before, my hope was to do those limited areas in the schools and then to start out 77 to do the strip. And then if we had more money to go to the shoulders to try to do those, my hope is that this $500,000 would do more of that. And then when we have an allocation next year's budget as well for paving, hopefully we do, that we begin to go out onto Sawyer Road in particular. Another major, major issue, and I still don't know where the monies are going to come from. If you've ever driven down Ram Island Farm from the Sprague Hall down toward Charles Jordan Road, that's still Fowler Road, that portion, that whole road's falling apart. And, you know, that's another, if we don't address that, you know, I don't know where all the money's going to come from to maintain all these roads. And my view is the more we can put into it, the better. So that is an increase from the four, whatever the number was, to 500.
Sir?
Can I ask you a few questions? Sorry.
It's okay with you, yeah.
So basically the $500,000 is paving. What's the most pressing paving that you sort of ascertained? Probably 77 and some of the parking lots.
Yes.
But there will be no drainage and no sidewalks in this particular bond right now.
There would be no, from this point on. I'm just trying to think if there's been any done up to now, but there's no sidewalks involved in any of that. In the school grounds and the parking lots, I don't think there's any, so.
So we're kicking that down the road for
that's,
the time.
That's out to pasture. It's no funding.
It
could conceivably compete for the 300, but I think there's gonna be so many things competing for that 300 that my guess is it might not rise to the top.
And then, sorry, may I ask him two more? When you say this is frozen, what does that mean?
That means I wouldn't have the right to spend any of it, and that in essence, you'd be, in May 2007, the town council voted for $1.25 million for these projects. The council would now be, in essence, removing that authorization and saying, Michael, you can't spend $300,000 of that money.
But where does it sit? Does it get interest? Is it?
Kryptonite? We're earning interest on these bond proceeds. Yeah.
So it just is in a.
It's in an interest-bearing account.
And finally, of this $300,000, would it be legitimate to spend that on school infrastructure, for example, a new roof, or some audit needs after the alternative energy audit is done?
Yeah, you know, I personally wouldn't spend it on the roof that we're talking about because that's in the current school budget. If the school board is choosing to cut that from their budget, you know, they're making that decision. You know, I worded carefully earlier that I will entertain recommendations and suggestions from everyone before making a proposal to the town council.
With this 300?
With the 300, and that was from, and I worded that carefully, from everyone.
Thank you.
Which would include schools. But if the schools need a roof repaired, you know, my view is, you know, that's, you know, it's in their budget right now. They're just choosing not to do it. And, you know, that's their choice. It's, you know, in the municipal, you know, we're making decisions or priorities all the time. And if the schools, you know, don't want that priority, plus You know, this is also very specifically worded. If the schools wish to rechannel the bond monies, the $76,000 to the roof, they can do that. It's this explicitly gives them that authorization.
And then this is my last question, I promise. If the audit finds some sort of really low-hanging fruit that could save money in the short term, would that come out of school budget money, municipal budget, or bonded money?
You know, I have to admit, I haven't read the audit's not done, and I haven't fully read the Alternative Energy Committee report. Those things, if they were bondable type items, if they had long range, we're not going to use it for something that's going to be gone in 3 years. But if it meets the other criteria for a bond, those would compete for these bond monies. Otherwise, they'd compete as part of the regular budget process.
Thank you.
Paul, and then David.
First of all, Michael, I appreciate your effort to put these principles and recommendations together. I think it demonstrates what most, if not all of us, have known all along, that you really, really do take this seriously, and you took the time and effort to reconsider. And I appreciate that in this particular time frame that we're dealing with, severe budget crisis. I have taken upon myself over the last few years, while I've been on the council, to travel to different parts of town from time to time to look at the infrastructure and just to see if we're doing our job well as a community and, you know, what's going on. And I can tell you that we have all sorts of needs. You know, the roads across town are crumbling, including my own neighborhood. And I really think, in some ways, sometimes we're penny wise and pound foolish. You know, our own frugality is possibly costing us. So I think we need to be careful moving forward. And I support these recommendations, Michael, because I think they're well thought out. And, you know, just going down 77, once you pass the intersection with Fowler and Old Ocean House, you know, it gets pretty rough. And even in the summertime, and Bob will attest to this, he rides a motorcycle as well. And on a motorcycle, you notice things like that a lot more rapidly than you do in a car. So I appreciate this, and I will support it.
David?
Thank you, Jim. I have, if I may, two questions of the manager. And I apologize for the first question, because I may have been reading while you were answering one of Sarah's questions and missed your answer. Did you give an estimate as to the amount of money for the school paving project?
No, I haven't done that yet.
Do you have an estimate of what you might expect that to be? In other words, the portion of the $500,000 that you're allocated, how much of that would you expect to be used for school?
I'm guessing it could be 100 and a quarter. You know, we haven't definitely decided the exact areas we're doing yet. And, you know, it's paving, you know, a barrel of crude oil went down $3 a barrel today. So it's, you know, it's a moving target. Do we have paving per ton prices yet for this year?
Yes, we do.
This coming year?
Yes, about 60.
Do you have any idea what the parking lots might be?
I don't know. It's about $62 a ton right now.
Yeah.
We'll be paying, but it's, you know, we could spend 1.5 possibly, but it depends on the work limits that we do.
Yeah.
Excuse me, 1.5 meaning
150,000.
Okay. And has this project been discussed with the superintendent and the school administration? And is it something that the school administration supports and would like to see done?
My understanding, I have spoken from time to time with the superintendent, particularly with concern with the dog bone, what I call the dog bone, the part going down to
the
track. That is about the worst. I don't think the superintendent's as aware of some of the science of pavement management on, you know, some of the areas down back. But I have discussed with him specifically the dog bone area. I also generally, you know, I don't like to promise the superintendent something before I've checked it out with the council too, you know, as well.
I would be willing to support this as proposed, but on the precondition that the superintendent and the school board extends an affirmative request that they would like the bond money used for this purpose. I'm hesitant to use bond money on school property and then for fear of hearing at some later date from people, why was this money spent for that purpose? The school had other needs or the town had other needs. And to have the school board itself or the school administration or somebody representing the school criticize the town for using the money for a purpose that they didn't approve.
David, I think you will hear that it should have been used for some other purpose. You know, the town is responsible for the maintenance of the outside of the schools. The reason that that was transferred to the town was that school boards traditionally had a lack of custodial respect for their property. It's in large part why a facilities manager was hired. It's because it was always the lowest priority for the schools. And, you know, therefore it was transferred to the town so that there'd be someone with an overall look at all of the different needs. You know, this is money that's not being paid for out of the school budget. You know, the schools, you know, might come forward with other priorities. You know, the schools were fully asked what would they like to be included in this bond. Everything was agreed to that they asked for. And, you know, I just, you know, if they say no, you know, then, you know, where do we stand at that point? You know, it's, you know, I just think sometimes we allowed ourselves to get needlessly boxed in to boxes that we later regret. And, you know, if the council wants to do that, I'll appreciate it. I'll go to them and with Bob and we'll explain to them why it needs to be done and all those different things. We would, you know, we'll go and explain it to them even if you don't do that. You know, put that specific requirement on there. But, you know, I don't want to get into the political give and take that's now going on between the town and the school, where just if in some respects if the idea comes from a different place, we need to be opposed to it. I hate to say that, but that's, you know, I think we all see some of the atmosphere, we all see what's going on, and, you know, you can't use bond money to buy books.
And to be clear, I'm not proposing that it be used to buy books, but if the school folks aren't of the opinion that those paving projects are required on school property, then I'd propose that the money be used to pave more roadway.
I would be happy, David, to support that request, that it be understanding if they say no, any future costs to pave those parking lots and driveways will be the responsibility of the school department and not of the municipal. Because when it begins to fall apart and they come running to us with a crisis, you know, the monies won't be there. And, you know, we'll be in a deep pickle. So as you can tell, I feel very strongly about this, and you know, I'm willing to accept, obviously, whatever the council does. But we have that custodial responsibility, and you know, certainly, I wouldn't want to do anything on the school grounds that, you know, that clearly be opposed to. I don't want to get into the situation where it begins competing for every priority of individual members, and we begin to have real challenges.
Paul.
I'd like to speak to this issue. David, I understand where you're coming from. What you're saying makes sense from the standpoint of the arguments we sometimes hear. So I have no issue with that. The issue I have is that we have a clearly defined set of roles and responsibilities, and one of the roles and responsibilities of the municipal government in the one town concept is the outside grounds, which includes the parking lots and the roadways of the school, even though it's on school property technically. And I think that we muddy the waters when we request permission or support for things like this. I think we should keep it clear. It's clearly delineated. We should leave it that way. If the town manager and his most able director here, transportation director, wants or thinks that something needs to be done with that infrastructure, as long as it makes sense, I think we should support it. That's how I feel. Because I think once you muddy the waters, there's no end in sight.
Thanks, Paul. Sarah?
I'm poised to support this because I trust what you're saying, but I just want to say philosophically, I agree with Rick Fontana that it seems worth putting a lot of money into enabling kids to drive their cars to school, which is the complete opposite of what the community should be doing, which is encouraging kids to walk and ride their bikes and, God forbid, take the bus. And I remember a year or two ago driving through the high school and thinking, geez, did they spend all the money for the renovation on pavement? This place looks like it's been paved over. So it's with frustration that I now am looking at paying for paving at the high school when I feel like all we've done lately is pave the high school. And I'm just philosophically opposed to providing lots of parking spaces at a high school when I actually think no child should be driving. So, painfully, I'll trust you, Mike, and vote for what you need.
Thanks, Sarah. Ann, and then David?
I just want to address Sarah's point. And I think she's right in that it is frustrating sometimes to think about paving the parking lots when there are things that could be higher priorities. But I think from our point of view, it's a school board policy decision as to whether we don't get to control whether kids get to drive to school or not. That's a school board policy decision. So as long as it is the school board policy to allow kids to drive to the high school, then we have to have safe parking for them. And so as much as I share some of David Backer's concerns about inevitably there will be people who will say, why did we spend money on this? Because we could have spent money on something else. And philosophically, I'm sort of there with Sarah on that particular issue, but I will be supporting Mike's recommendations. Because I think he's steering us in a fiscally prudent direction.
Dave?
I agree with the sentiments of Ann and Sarah and David. I'm going to vote in favor of this. I really appreciate the town manager taking the initiative to give us more flexibility on a go-forward basis by setting aside some of the bonded funds for projects that we might deem more worthy at a future date. Responding to Mr. Fontana's concern and Ann's last comment as well, it is a school board policy. When I was campaigning, some people suggested that students be charged a fee for parking. I don't know if that fee already exists. My teenage son will probably view me with horror when I come home tonight, though of course he's not watching this discussion anyway. But that's something that I would urge the school board to take up. The parking lots, though, aren't only there for the students, they're also there for members of the public in CAPE and beyond for all of the various events that take place at the school. So I do see a need to maintain them. And perhaps we can steer our children to be more green, because that's something I hear from my son a lot. But that's an issue for the school board.
Thanks, Dave. I did much of my negotiating on this issue through the course of the day and a couple of phone conversations with the manager, and I'm happy with the results. And I do want to thank him for being responsive to concerns. And I sense that we're probably at a point where we could accept the motion. Ann?
I'd like to move that we approve the recommendations 1-6 laid out in Mike McGovern's January 12th page entitled Vaughan Principles and Recommendations.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any further discussion on this issue or on the motion? Seeing none, all in favor of the motion? Show it to be unanimous, please. Thank you. Thank you, Mike. Item 32-2009, Alternative Energy Committee report. We did receive the report electronically, and we have it on the tables before us tonight. And it's my understanding that the committee would like to make a presentation tonight. So I would invite whoever is going to speak to come to the lectern and make a presentation for us. I first want to, while you're making your way there, I just am blown away by this report. I wish I were more technologically inclined than I am. My I'm very limited in that respect, both energy-wise and computer-wise. And if you can provide me with help in my own personal computer, I'd help that. I'd appreciate that too. But we look forward to your presentation, and thank you all for your work.
You're welcome. Hi, my name is Bill Slack, and I was the chair of the committee this past year. And as Jim mentioned, the report is rather lengthy, and our intent is to go over all the details of it, but to provide a brief overview for you. I'm going to give a brief overview, and Wyman Briggs and Alan Lishness are going to discuss several concepts in the report that in a little bit more detail. We've worked on this. We've been a committee for this past year, met meeting once per month, and we've worked on this report during that period, and so this is a culmination of that effort. To recap, you know, the council, you asked us to explore opportunities to provide alternative energy to municipal and school buildings and vehicles. The committee shall make recommendations in the form of a report to the town council and school board, providing specific proposals and cost estimates. Any recommendations with cost impacts shall include cost to implement as well as projected cost savings. The committee will provide a report with recommendations by December. We missed that by a couple of weeks, and I'm going to blame that on the ice storm. I first off wanted to give, when we started this, we first met last year. We had lots of great ideas, and we're swirling all around, and could see that we weren't getting anything on a piece of paper, so I want to give kudos to Wyman Briggs, who brought in a grad student from the Kennedy School of Government at Harvard and convinced him to do his thesis on alternative energy strategy for Cape Elizabeth schools. And so that was a very good template for us to work from. A lot of good research went into that and a lot of good methodology. So we kind of leveraged that report, and we didn't have to start with a blank piece of paper. Concurrent with the report, we worked with the facilities manager and Mike to get some bids solicited for energy audit at the schools, and you know, in part, and that process is going on right now. Not only will it look at various energy conservation measures that could be implemented in the schools, you know, the lighting, the building envelope, efficiency upgrades to motors and different things, but controls, but they'll also be looking at these energy alternative technology measures that we've and so it'll give us a validation of what we're or not of what we are recommending here in our report. The committee, the council didn't ask us to specifically to look at reducing greenhouse gas emissions, but it really goes hand in hand with reducing fossil fuels, that you're going to be reducing greenhouse gas emissions and part of this global climate change issue. So in our report, we've talked to that as well as what we see as the estimated carbon CO2 emissions reductions for each of the alternative options that we've selected. And I think you mentioned earlier, Cool Cape will be making a presentation, I think next month to you about a petition to have a stated objective on greenhouse gas emissions for the community of Cape Elizabeth, and we as a committee support that. Basically, the methodology that we used, we looked at a net present value analysis with every alternative we looked at. We wanted to, especially in light of the budget issues, have a positive net present value. That is to say that it's energy savings would be able to would be greater than the debt service that we would have to pay on a bond or so forth like that. We know that was an important criteria. The study focused primarily on the schools because they are the biggest energy users for the municipal town for this between the municipal buildings and the schools. 2.2 million kilowatt hours and 150,000 gallons of oil per year is what we're currently consuming there. We didn't get into a lot of details on vehicle savings, but we did touch on some aspects, some things other communities are doing. And those are you can find those in the report. The report came up with some major findings and some major recommendations. There's a lot of backup calculations and analysis and tables and discussion of the various technologies and assumptions. One assumption, clearly the area we concentrate on is the high school, because that's the oldest, needs the most work. I think it's 1969 vintage. So one of the assumptions is that's not going to be replaced in the next few years. If that's, you know, somebody's idea of what's going to happen, then that would change some of our conclusions. But some of our findings basically are that the energy conservation measures should be implemented first. And I think that any energy program you hear people talk about, that'll be the first thing they talk about. That will provide the best return on investment. We saw that wood-fired boiler does have a positive net present value in all cases. Conversion to natural gas is a viable option, with the caveat that there is a gas pipeline that would have to be brought in from South Portland, and the costs of that have not been refined. We're still kind of guesstimating that. Wind turbine and geothermal show positive net present values for a sensitivity case where there's low borrowing cost, like if we could get clean renewable energy bonds at 0%. Solar PV, solar thermal do not show positive net present value, but there are opportunities for grants and incentives. So with those, there could be an opportunity there. And a cogeneration application using natural gas did not show a positive net present value, basically because of the requirements to bring in the gas line and the price of gas that we were using in our study. Our recommendations were basically to proceed with this third-party consultant to do the energy audit, and that's underway. As already mentioned, I think Mike authorized CM3 to begin work last month, and they've already been over at the high school. They've met with Ernie and are working away on the process right now. The result of that, they'll have a list of energy conservation measures that can be implemented. They'll show the cost to implement and the return on investment and the savings and so forth, so we can pick and choose which measures to implement. And they're doing this for the school buildings, this building, all the municipal buildings as well, going through the process. And they will also look at the technology measures that we've been looking at, and which include the energy conservation, solar, wind, wood chip, geothermal and natural gas and cogeneration. They'll also identify the technical feasibility of those and compare them to our results. Their report will be basically an investment grade analysis, so it'll be something that we can use to proceed or go to the next level. So that process will take several months, and so I would imagine at the end of that process in several months we'll have another decision point and probably come back and have another, this compares with our report or it doesn't, and this is ways we can proceed from here. We're recommending that we proceed with a wind turbine site survey. I'm going to let Wyman discuss that in a little bit more detail. Assuming that the, council accepts our work and wants to proceed, we're recommending that we try to build community awareness for the measures and the alternative energy technologies that we want to deploy, so they understand the costs and benefits and so forth. And we can do that through, articles and forums, articles in the paper, forums. We could have meetings and so forth like that, invite them to our meetings. We're recommending that we now begin to work hard on looking for funding With the new Obama administration coming in, one of their agenda items has been, as we all know, to been to you know, support infrastructure and renewable energy infrastructure. So the timing, you know, if we can get our ducks lined up, the timing has never been better to really look at you know, alternative energy funding for any technologies we want to deploy here. We're recommending that we, you know, for the technologies that we want to proceed with, get some firm pricing and full cost appraisal. And we are basically doing that with our third-party consultant that's underway, so we're working hand-in-hand with that. We're recommending that the town of Cape Elizabeth join the U.S. Mayor's Climate Protection Agreement, and you'll be hearing more about that from the Cool Cape Community, or Cool Cape Committee, or Grassroots Committee that we'll be presenting to you in the next month. And we recommend that we participate in Greater Portland Council of Governments. They have a local government for sustainability regional assessment. It's an ICLEI software program. We've been working with Steve Linnell this whole past year, and they haven't got the program running, but once they do, it'll be a way to assess our greenhouse gas inventories in this town, and not only with our town, but with the region, and sort of have a way to have a common goals for the whole region, not just locally in our town. It's a pretty extensive report. You know, we'd ask that you read it, and you know, we would come back in another several months after the audit's in with more information, more details, and confirmation of what we have in the report. And with that, I wanted to have Wyman just give a little bit of a discussion on what we're planning to do, or what we're thinking of doing relative to wind turbines, and then Alan will give a little bit of a discussion on some more visionary concepts for Cape Elizabeth that we're thinking of in the long term. Thank you.
Thank you, Bill.
Good evening. I'm Wyman Briggs. I live at 3 Mountain View Road, and I had the privilege to work over the last year on the Alternative Energy Committee under really extraordinary leadership by Bill Slack, who was able to herd all of our cats together, keep us moving in the same direction, and did a tremendous job in bringing it all together at the end. I think he must have spent most of the holidays working on it, and it shows. Really, really extraordinary work. Also appreciated the opportunity to work with several members in the town, including Mike, as well as Ernie McVeigh, who contributed substantially in terms of bringing in the town's perspective, and he really has a mastery of all the numbers and all the energy expenditures by the different facilities, and has already done a lot of work himself in terms of locating efficiencies. I'm going to focus on one of the 8 different alternatives that we looked at, not because it's the best and the only recommendation, but just to kind of illustrate some of the work that still needs to be done. Now that we've done kind of an overview survey of all the different alternatives, our committee, as we presented at an earlier update to the town council, is planning to continue on. Much of the work yet to be done is kind of working into the details where we can both refine the alternatives in terms of identifying more of the specifics of whether they're as feasible as they looked initially, as also in addition to finding potential cost savings such as subsidized bonds or other grants that would make any of the alternatives we would pursue more affordable. Wind energy is the fastest growing renewable energy alternative in the country, as well as in New England. And you also hear much about it in Maine, for example, with the larger wind farms which have been erected on mountaintops to the north of us, as well as smaller municipal structures. I know the town council's already spent quite a bit of time discussing the municipal wind turbine provisions, as well as neighboring towns such as Saco that have already moved forward on a wind turbine. On the first cut, when we looked at wind energy, is to look at what information is out there in terms of what the wind resource is here in the Cape Elizabeth. And that's measured quite broadly by a company called True Wind that's done kind of a wind, broad wind assessment for the whole state of Maine. And based on that, they measure that the, a broad estimate of the wind speed is between 4.5 and 5.5 meters per second at 100 feet above Cape Elizabeth. And given that broad assessment, that does make a wind turbine similar to the one that's used in Saco viable. That's within the range. However, we also wanted to really, the other thing that we looked at, the same True Wind measurement provides a measurement at a higher elevation of 70 meters, 210 feet. And for that, the estimate would be a wind speed of 6 to 7 meters per second. The important thing is, as you've heard in earlier discussions about wind turbine energy and wind speed, is an increase in wind speed is a factor of 4 increase in power. So, a doubling in the wind speed brings an 8 times impact in terms of the amount of power they can generate. So with that, we already wanted to bring in a consultant or a wind engineer to get a precise measurement of wind speed in various locations around Cape Elizabeth. One of those being at the schools, which is a great potential site. Both anecdotally, we've heard from many that's a consistently windy location. And also it's a distance from residential areas, so it makes for a good, and it's a fairly large plot of land. So it does inherently make a good location for a wind turbine. The other piece is we've brought in the high school's environmental club, and they've expressed a strong interest in teaming up with the Alternative Energy Committee. First as part of the science of it, which is bringing in an engineer to erect an anemometer to measure the wind speed at several heights. And from that, we can get a better appreciation for what the change in wind speed is at altitude. And we're actually meeting this Friday with a wind engineer that's given us a very very economic rate to do the first a first study to set up an anemometer for a period of either 3 months or 12 months and figure out both the wind speed as well as the consistency of the wind. So that's the first element that we really need to nail down in order to determine the feasibility of putting in a wind turbine. The one thing that we want to be open to is the possibility that if there's a substantially higher wind speed at 200 feet than 100 feet, for example, to consider that the town council would potentially consider a proposal if the economics makes sense for a larger than 100-foot wind turbine, like say a 70-meter or 210-foot wind turbine. Part of it is that you have higher winds higher up, but you also have great efficiencies of scale with a larger turbine. One 200-foot turbine generates approximately tenfold the amount of of power that we could generate from a 100-foot wind turbine. So we'd like to have the council be open-minded in looking at that type of proposal if it seems to make sense based on the measurements that we're going to have done by the wind engineer. So we want to, we're also obviously cognizant of the fact of that there's some concerns that citizens may have with wind turbines too, particularly the visual impact. So that'll all, that'll come more into the political process, which I know you'll be more involved in than us. But we very much look forward to over the next few months getting, you know, refining that portion of our analysis, getting some professional estimates and measurements in, and developing a more refined proposal for you both on, you know, one thing that I'm working on is the wind energy, but also on some of the other of the eight different alternatives that we're looking at, as well as the conservation assessment that's going on. Now I'd like to turn it over to Alan Leishness that's also been thinking outside the box and looking at this from a broader perspective. Thank you.
Thanks, Wyman.
Mr. Chair, members of the council, thanks for having us tonight. My name is Alan Leishness. I live at 21 Cottage Farms Road, and I'm compelled to point out that it's in awesome condition, thanks to the work that the Town of Cape Elizabeth has done there. And I also want to take just a moment, I'm going to tell you a little story, but I want to take a moment to just thank Bill Slack. You guys did a great job appointing this committee. This committee worked really well together. And Bill is one of the best chairs I've ever worked with, and I've served on a lot of committees. The emails were flying last week, and he did a lot of work. All of us read it and proofed it and all that sort of thing, but the heavy lifting was really done at the end by Bill. And what you have there is not just a final report, but the fabric of a year's worth of meetings. I would read things in that report, and I go, wow, yeah, somebody did say that 10 months ago, and he remembered. So he's done a really awesome job. So I want to kind of tell you a little story. When we started this work, kind of the feeling I had was, well, the council has seen that some other communities are doing some things with wind energy. Let's take Saco, for example. They put a windmill in at the dump, and front page news for weeks, and everybody was going down to Saco to look at it. And there was this little bit of a sense that, geez, maybe we should start experimenting with something. And I'm here with a little bit of a different message. That is, we don't really gain anything, and we don't provide any great service by experimenting. If we were to put up a 100-foot windmill, with all due respect, big deal. There are thousands, if not tens of thousands, of 100-foot windmills. So we feel all the issues. We're aware of what people say. We know how hard it is. But what I'm here to talk about is a bigger vision. And that vision is to say, okay, how far can Cape go toward reducing its carbon footprint and becoming a truly energy-efficient community? And the proxy I would suggest is an interesting town in Denmark. It's an island. It's called Samsø. It's 12 miles off the coast of Copenhagen. 4,200 people, so it's not unlike Cape Elizabeth in scale. 10 years ago, the community of Samsø was 100% reliant on imported oil. That was getting really, really expensive. So remember, this is 1998, just 10 years ago. They said, we believe we can eliminate our reliance on imported oil. Guess what? 10 years later, not only do they buy no oil, but they are net energy exporters. And the guy who led this effort has come here to Maine to talk. He's been brought here by the Island Institute, and several of us went to hear him speak when he was at the Portland Museum of Art a couple of months ago. And he was an utterly inspiring guy, and he told a really interesting story. The community won a design contest that was put together by the Danish government to see who could come up with a plan to be the most energy efficient community. So they won, and there was no money. They were disappointed to learn that there wasn't a big prize and nobody was going to pay them to do it. They did manage a few years later to raise $10 million from the Danish government, but the cost for them to become energy independent was $75 million. So they bonded. This little community of 4,200 people bonded the other $65 million. And they did it with great enthusiasm. And particularly the model for the windmill ownership was interesting. The municipality, there are 11 offshore windmills, and the municipality owns 5 of them, and a couple of farmers each own 1. And the residents own almost all the rest, whatever that balance is, but there was 1 left over that they hadn't figured out how to pay for, so they went to the summer residents who come to Samsø, and they got them to pay for it. And every summer, they take them on a boat ride out around their windmills. It was sort of interesting to read about this, because a Cape resident came to our committee and said, well, what do you think about individuals making investments in this big infrastructure? And having just read this story and heard this guy speak, I thought, geez, that's a really interesting idea. How many people in Cape Elizabeth do you think would like to own a share of a major renewable energy generation system? And so then I mentioned that Island Institute had brought this fellow here to speak. And the reason that's interesting is that the citizens of Vinyl Haven and North Haven, right here in our conservative state of Maine, are going to install 3 windmills. Guess how tall they are? I mean, many of you participated in the council deliberations about whether the town would allow a windmill tower of 100 feet. Wyman talked about how twice the wind speed gives you 8 times the power. The good citizens of Vinyl Haven and North Haven are installing 3 400-foot windmills. Now, you might think, hey, we have to run for office, and this is really contentious. People are worried about birds, they're worried about bats, they're worried about what it looks like. I don't know if anybody read the story on the vote in Vinyl Haven and North Haven. 382 in favor, 5 against. So I would argue that a lot of what we hear is posturing, and it's not really what people think about these sort of important matters. So what I would ask of you as a council and as our leaders in the community is to continue to be forward-thinking, continue to be brave, and most of all, to be ambitious. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Alan. Bill Wyman, thank you. And I wish you would convey our thanks to the rest of your committee as well. I think tonight we just gained a tremendous appreciation for the amount of work that's already gone into this committee, and you obviously are not done. You're in progress of talking with the consultants. I guess my thinking right now is that we need to bring this to a workshop where we can really get into this thing a little bit better, and also to perhaps kick around a strategy for moving forward together, rather than just try to come up with an idea tonight. So I think what I would like to do, if it's okay with you guys, is to move that we refer this to a workshop and maybe leave it up to you as to when might be the good time, because I know you're in the middle of consultations with people, and you'll have a few more answers perhaps a short time down the road. And it might be better to wait until you get some more of those answers. Or does that make sense? Okay, well, why don't we leave it up to you to contact Mike, perhaps, and let us know when you're ready to kind of get into this thing and get us into this thing a little deeper, and we'll look forward to that.
I think you were alluding to after we get the energy audit.
Yeah, energy audit, and they're talking about the wind consultant this week, and get some of those things going, and we may have a few more answers.
We'll figure it out.
Okay. Thank you very much. Tremendous work, and I'm looking forward to reading it. I did skim through about 3/4 of it online, and it's fascinating.
Jim?
Yeah?
Just a question. Do we have to, I don't know if we're required to formally receive the report and refer it to a workshop?
Good idea.
Because I'd be happy to second your motion.
Okay.
I made a motion, so I didn't know if we needed to vote on it. So.
Okay, well, I'll make my comments a motion. You seconded it. Discussion on the motion? Paul?
I would like to commend the Alternative Energy Committee. You guys, when we first started out with this concept, we really, you know, the idea we had in mind was to save energy, save costs, and I, for one, and I think others, were thinking that what the work that you put together could really be the model for the entire region. And I'm very, very impressed, and I think that's exactly what it's going to become. So thanks very much for your efforts.
Mike?
Yeah, I want to thank the committee, but I also want to thank Sarah Lennon, because Sarah really kept me informed as well as the committee. Has been a good cheerleader of this group, and you know, particularly when it was time to fund the energy audit, some of those things brought all those needs together. So I really want to thank Sarah as well as the committee for all their work on this. Thank you.
David?
And I'd just like to add, we have seen a lot of very impressive reports that have been generated over the years. This one sets a new standard by which reports of committees will be measured likely forever. And it was really a stroke of genius to corral the fellow from the Kennedy School. To bring him into this. So congratulations and thank you.
Further discussion on the motion? Seeing none, all in favor? Show it to be unanimous, please. Thank you again. Item number 33-2009, we have an appointments committee recommendation. Paul?
Yes. I would recommend that we accept Chris Gebhardt from 98 Fowler Road as a new member of the Arts Commission to fill that vacant slot.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion on the motion. Seeing none. All in favor? Unanimous. Thank you, Paul. We have a recommendation coming out of the Ordinance Committee regarding bed and breakfasts, and it is recommended to set these recommendations for a public hearing on Monday, February 9th at 7:30 p.m. at the Cape Elizabeth Town Hall. Sarah, did you have any comments you'd like to give on the Ordinance Committee's deliberations?
I can give you a brief history of how this came about and then what the actual recommendation is. I don't know if it's appropriate to do tonight, or shall I wait?
I'll leave that up to you. I didn't know if you wanted to speak tonight. You certainly will be asked to speak when it comes back to us.
What's the pleasure of the Ordinance Committee? Do you want me to update everyone now, or just pass it along to the...
I think it would be helpful for the public who might be deciding whether or not they want to come to the public hearing, if you have a brief...
Okay, I'll just try to be very brief.
If you would, that's great.
Basically, the town council referred to the planning board a request by a citizen 2 years ago who was interested in opening a bed and breakfast in his house. So the planning board surveyed the regulations, and they first defined something called a homestay, which allows two people to stay for one night, and they set that in one category. And then they tried to establish what a bed and breakfast would be. And they essentially, briefly, they liked the idea of allowing some of the older homes and the charming places in Cape Elizabeth to open their doors to some guests and visitors, and they thought it would be a benefit to the community. So it sounds like they went through a rather lengthy process of opening it up quite far and trying to allow bed and breakfasts both on main roads and also in residences. And then they had a public hearing, and a lot of people showed up and said, hey, we don't want bed and breakfast in residential areas. So they went back and they deliberated again, came back and said, okay, we'll only have it in the town center district. And then people came back to the second public hearing and said, hey, wait a minute, we would like to have it be, apparently this went on for months, we would like actually to open up a little bit more because there's these charming houses and they would be great for it too, and so forth. So they went back and they deliberated again. And what they finally proposed is quite close to what we are now putting forth for the council to consider, and it is this. A bed and breakfast would be allowed in the town center district, the BA district, which is currently being decided in the Ordinance Committee what that is, and the RA and RC districts where the lot has frontage on Route 77 and Shore Road. So essentially what it's saying is you can either be in a business district and have a bed and breakfast, or you have to have frontage on the two major roads in town. So they kind of set aside the more minor roads and the residential areas for the time being. Then there's a few further restrictions. Bed and breakfast in the residential districts must be, i.e. frontage on Shore Road and 77, must be operated by the owner who maintains the structure as his or her primary residence. A pseudo density requirement was added to the residential district that limits the number of bedrooms to one per 20,000 square foot of lot area in the RC district and one per 80,000 square feet of lot area in the RA district, which we'll go into in more detail, I presume, next month. And finally, the definition throughout the town caps the maximum number of rooms at 9 at all bed and breakfasts, and they all require a site plan review by the planning board, which takes up issues of lighting and noise and buffering and so forth. So, in summary, it's opening the town up to allow some bed and breakfast, but in a rather modest way, small bed and breakfast, to make sure there's enough lot size that the house itself is large enough and that the owner, except for the town center, that the owner actually lives there and therefore has a lot of investment and care in how the place is run. Is that fair?
Yes.
And so I'd like to propose that we schedule a public hearing for Monday, February 9th at our next town meeting.
It's a motion.
It's a motion.
Second.
Seconded by Dave. Anne.
I just have a couple of questions. Because I read through, I'm no expert on the planning, the zoning ordinances by any stretch of the imagination. But when I went through this, I only saw the RA and the RC districts mentioned in the text that was attached to this matter. But I heard you just say, and it's my understanding that bed and breakfast would be allowed in the town center and the BA districts also. And I think it would be really helpful for me, I don't know if the rest of the counselors would find this helpful or not, but just sort of a little bullet point thing, rather than just have the text, to sort of dredge out which districts is it allowed in. And when I looked at, for instance, the size of the lot in the RA zone and the RC zone, I think I thought it was different numbers than what you just said in your overview. So I want to make sure I understand. So it would be very helpful, Maureen could probably do this, just to say town center, sort of what the key requirements are. You know, there's some stuff in here about frontage on Shore Road, Route 77, and some of these districts, the owner-operator thing. You know, just so I could see, maybe it's the same for all four of those districts, but I would find that more helpful to me in my decision-making and understanding the issue than just having the text here.
So you want to know, you want it broken down by each of the four districts and say what exactly the requirements and the restrictions are.
Yeah, and just in, I mean, just the highlights. You don't I don't have
executive summary.
I don't need, you know, all the accessory uses and all this other stuff, all the other text. I'm looking for, on the B&Bs, does the owner-operator thing apply to all four of those districts? Does the nine-room maximum apply to all four of those districts? The minimum frontage on Shore Road, which districts, that sort of thing. And I guess there's some parking requirements, and I just want to know what those are. So more like a little chart or something. That would just be helpful. And I think it might be helpful for citizens, you know, since it'll be online, it might be helpful for citizens to understand.
Good idea.
That.
Other comments? It's been moved and seconded to refer this to public hearing. All in favor? Show it to be unanimous, please. Item 35-2009, Recycling Working Group Report. Anne, would you like to speak to this as well?
Yes. No, just one second.
I'll let you get your bed and breakfast stuff put away. And
thank you. Well, we're talking about scheduling this for public hearing, but basically the report from the Recycling Working Group is a document that was dated December 1st, and it was in our packet under item number 28 earlier in the meeting. Basically, we met, Councilor Lennon and I and Mike McGovern, Bob Malley, and then Rachel Stumiashkin from the Recycling Committee, and then at the last meeting, Mike, help me out, was the person who replaced her.
We had an additional person from the Recycling
One additional person. I'm sorry, I've forgotten the name.
Jennifer Hansen.
Thank you, yes.
Well done.
So we met a number of times, three or four times, and we discussed paper bag, we discussed curbside pickup, we discussed recycling education, we discussed recycling center hours, which we dealt with earlier in this meeting. And we came, after much discussion and analysis and multiple charts showing recycling rates and determining estimates, I mean, we actually did put a lot of work in it. The memo is short, but we considered a lot of different things. The working group came up with recommendations for the following changes or enhancements to our recycling programs. First, an enhanced program of recycling education that would generate long-term savings of $18,000 per year at present values. Secondly, a change in recycling center hours, which is what we dealt with earlier this evening. That will immediately generate about $14,000 annually in net savings. And thirdly, we are recommending amendments to the solid waste ordinance that will require recycling. And what that means is we don't have anything on the books, any ordinances on the books right now that say you're supposed to recycle. So if you have someone at the recycling center working there and talking to people about at the hopper, gee, you really nicely should be recycling that, the person could say, why? I don't have to. And there's nothing there. So we thought we might want to look at some sort of ordinance so that it would put a little bit of teeth in there so that there would be some force beyond moral suasion that recycling is a thing that will benefit the town, and thus we should have some rules about it. So those are our recommendations. And I would move that we set this report and these recommendations for public hearing on Monday, February 9th, 2009 at 7:30 p.m. At that council meeting.
Second.
Moved and seconded.
Yeah, I'd like to stop real quick, particularly because the Jordans are waiting. I think there's two other important recommendations, and that's that there not be paper bag and that there not be curbside pickup. They're in the negative, so they weren't mentioned in the recommendations, but I think when we advertise the public hearing, we'll include those as part of the recommendation.
Yes, thank you, Mike, for that addition. I was focusing on what we did recommend, but we talked about a lot of other things and decided that given the changes involved and all the various variables about the recycling rates that we thought would result from doing some of these things, that the benefits were not were outweighed by the potential costs at this point. Not to say we would never look at those things, but
so that's an acceptable amendment.
I'll add what Mike said to my motion.
Okay, thank you. Further discussion?
Oh, and I do want to thank the committee, especially the folks from the recycling committee and Bob Malley and Mike and everybody who worked on it, because it's very mushy and it's difficult data, but it's a really important issue. And as Councilor McKinney has pointed out repeatedly, it is a huge number in our budget. And if we all recycled more, we could save the town a lot of money. So it's important that we focus on it.
Thank you for bringing firmness to the mushiness.
Thank you.
Further comment? All in favor of the motion? That's unanimous as well. Thank you, Ann. Item 36-2009, Fort Williams Park group use request for 2009. We have a list of requests. We don't need to read them through them tonight. Notably absent, I would tell the public, is the annual Independence Pops concert from the Portland Symphony. They've decided not to do that program this year, so I know citizens, many of us, will be disappointed not to have that. But the others are pretty much yearly returns from yearly requests from Cape Elizabeth Little League, Family Fun Day, high school graduation, other items that we're used to seeing at the Ford each year. So I would entertain a motion to approve those requests. David?
I move that we approve the Fort Williams Park group use requests for 2009 as listed in our agenda.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Mike?
Just for purpose of disclosure, both Councilor Backer and I serve on the TD Bank North Committee, and I haven't abstained, and I don't think David needs to either, from discussion of this, but we should both disclose that we're on their board. Okay.
So disclosed.
Well, I'll disclose that I was the first chairman of the Cape Elizabeth Fire Department Engine 1 Labor Day weekend art show. But no longer have an interest. I have an interest in going, but not running it. Further discussion? All in favor? Unanimous. Thank you. And now, Jordans. We have a item number 37-2009. It's recommended to authorize the town manager to renew agreement with the William H. Jordan Farm, LLC, for the management and handling of compost material at the recycling center. Mike, would you like to speak to this?
Yeah, and I think Carol Ann's here if you have any questions, Penny as well, but Carol Ann is the spokesperson. This is a win-win all the way around. It originally started, Scott Collins, a local resident, came to us and I think formed an outfit called Cape Compost and took over all of our handling of compost materials. It's something we had devoted hundreds of hours to prior to our equipment and personnel. Scott came in and took it over. Then he decided not to do any more, talked to the Jordans. And, you know, what really makes it win-win is that it's recycling all this material. It's not going into the hopper. It's easy for citizens to dispose of. The Jordans then do all of the work involved, the Jordan Farm, and Mark Butterfield, who's part of the family, all of the work involved in handling the pile, you know, churning it over and over. And then what's really nice is then they take it away and they sell it. And they also sell it at the family farm. So, you know, it's also a win because it's helping to preserve one of Cape Elizabeth's family farms by adding another revenue source from them, and the fact that it's available to local residents, this recycled material, as well as they sell it outside of town as well. But it's been a wonderful relationship. Not that I deal with it very often, but we've really, really pleased to work with the William H. Jordan farm on this. And as you noted, there was a provision in the predecessor agreement that we would talk about it now, but that it doesn't expire till a year from now. For various reasons, we thought, for planning purposes and for other reasons you can imagine, we decided that it would be best to handle it now and get it approved for the next 5 years. So this would continue it until February 21st, 2015. But the staff, Bob Malley, myself, we couldn't be any more pleased with the way the William H. Jordan Farm has handled this. And it's always fun to meet with the representatives of the farm, although now it won't be again for another 5 years on a formal basis, so that we do agree that we meet once a year, just to go over all the operations in a formal sense. And if those who don't know, Carol Ann Jordan is one of the Jordan family members and
works with the compost.
Yeah, amongst other things.
Mark meets with Bob regularly, we definitely should meet and try to meet formally once a year, but he and Bob interact frequently throughout the year.
Any questions of Carol Ann while she's at the lectern?
I have a question, Carol Ann. I think you're doing a great job, very valuable resource for the town. My question, it relates to other compostable material. As we look at more recycling efforts, we all realize that some of the heaviest items that we dispose of in the hopper are compostable materials. You know, if you let's say we cook a squash, we don't eat the outside. You know, we put it in the trash, and there it goes. It's heavy, and we pay by tonnage for trash. Are there any opportunities working with the farm to do some recycling of that type of other types of compostable material besides yard waste and leaves?
Are you thinking food waste specifically?
I'm just wondering what's possible with food waste exactly.
That's a discussion that's excluded from this or kept at a minimum as part of this, because it's a whole different composting process than leaf and yard waste. And also, I think there are different DEP regulations or EPA whichever alphabet takes care of that, related to food waste as opposed to the leaf and yard waste. But what's outlined in the current agreement and the proposed agreement is based on our current, I'm trying to think of the right word, permit with the DEP.
Okay.
Through the town.
If there were any thoughts or discussions relating to any of these other items. And so I don't know.
Anything's open for...
As a farm, you guys turn over a lot of your excess...
We have our own little compost pile.
And I don't know what's possible, Michael, or if you've thought about this.
It certainly could be discussed.
Okay.
There's also issues with, you know, we don't want to encourage vermin any more than we already potentially have there. And that's an issue with food waste.
And space is another issue.
Yeah.
What else?
Space.
Oh, space, of course.
The space at the...
All right, well, just a thought.
But nothing's, you know, anything's open for discussion, because the more we recycle, I mean, the better it is, so... Yes, ma'am.
Sarah?
I just had a question. The community gardens, I know, get big piles of, I think it's compost or enriched soil. Is that part of this loop?
Yes, yes, they get, yeah. Yeah, and we do sell the compost from our farms, through our farm, but we, one thing we try to do, because we are able to make it locally and deal with it so close to home, that we try to offer it at the most economical price we can. So people always say they want the cheap stuff, but we like to tell them it's the most affordable stuff, not the cheap stuff. It's the best stuff.
Other questions, comments? Thanks, Caroline. Oh, David,
one
I'm sorry.
Question for Caroline. On the quality control provision of the agreement, it says that on a batch basis, the compost will be tested for maturity and also will be tested by an independent lab. Who pays for that testing?
We do.
And is the testing by an independent lab done on the same frequency as
the maturity?
The batch basis?
For no. The maturity testing is done more frequently than the lab testing. Okay. Lab testing is done annually, and the maturity testing is done during the processing to ensure that it's matured.
And are the results of those tests shared with the town?
They haven't been formally shared with the town. They're available to people upon request. We have people ask for them. We have customers ask about it, and we're able to give them that information.
Yeah, this is more a provision that some of the, it doesn't have to be an agreement, but it is something that the customers wish to know to make sure that it's good compost.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
They have some very large customers, who I'm not publicly mentioning because I don't want anyone else to try to sell the material. So they have some very large customers that have exacting quality control standards.
Thanks, Caroline. We do need a formal motion. Paul?
I move that we authorize the town manager to renew the agreement with the William H. Jordan Farm LLC for the management and handling of compost material at the recycling center.
Second. Seconded, Ann. I heard first. Close. You came in a close third. Second. Sarah. Discussion on the motion? David?
The problem with being a lawyer is that when you're given an agreement, you feel like you need to read it. I have a few very small suggestions.
Are they substantive, David?
One of them, yes.
Okay. Because the non-substantive ones, I would assume the council would mind if we edited it. But if they're substantive, you should disclose them.
The only one really of substance that I'd like to suggest is it on the top of page 4, and it for the paragraph that's titled agreement, it has some provisions for what's supposed to happen 30 days from receipt of notice, and then the town has to do something 9 months before the agreement ends. And my concern is obligating the town to do something 9 months before the agreement ends, and it doesn't really say what happens, but the suggestion is if the town misses that 9-month deadline, maybe the agreement is automatically extended. And my preference would be that the language here be changed to say that in substance, that if the parties, that the agreement will terminate on its own if the farm and the town doesn't enter into terms for a new agreement at least 6 months before the termination.
Rather than it automatically go to a successor agreement.
Right, and this doesn't even say that it automatically goes to a successor agreement, but it suggests that it might.
So if I offered that language to the William Jordan Farm and they were agreeable, my sense of what's, the council would not need this to return.
Correct.
Caroline says it's good.
I agree with you.
Okay.
And I'll point out the other couple of things.
Yeah, good. Yes.
Other discussion on the motion? Seeing none. All in favor of the motion? Unanimous. 6-0. Thank you, Jordan, for hanging around. Item 38-2009, proposed town council working group. This idea came originally from our council caucus and our organizing session for the year. And Dave Sherman, new counselor, was very interested in developing a policy for effective use of email communication with citizens, trying to enhance communication between the council and citizens. And we all jumped on board with that. We thought it was a great idea. And since then, there were a couple other issues that have come to our attention that probably need our attention as well. And they're related, not exactly the same, but they're related. They're in the communications area. And so we thought it might be prudent to lump those issues together into one working group. And so it's been proposed that an ad hoc working group consist of three council members to be appointed by the chairman. I don't know if we need to make that in a formal motion. We did discuss this at our workshop meeting on the 6th. Is it your sense that we need a motion to? Okay, we will need a motion for the to give the council chairman the ability to appoint this committee. So.
So moved.
Moved by Ann.
Second.
Seconded by Paul.
Are you approving the charge that was in that memo too? That came with it.
Yes. Yes.
Basically, it was the
yep.
3 points that they
yep.
would look at the CETV guidelines.
Right.
They would look at the email distribution list.
Yep.
And third.
And evaluation of the municipal website
yeah.
to ensure that it remains one of the premier municipal websites in Maine.
So it's the charge that was in the workshop.
Yes, back the same one.
Materials.
Right. Moved and seconded. Discussion on the motion? Seeing none, all in favor? It's unanimous. We had discussion on this at the workshop. I will hereby name the committee to be Dave Sherman, Ann Swift-Gadda, and myself. And I would name Ann to be chairman of that committee if she's willing.
Great.
Thank you, Ann. Leave it up to you to call the first meeting. We can get together either after.
At the end of this meeting, if we could just huddle with our calendars.
That'd be fine.
Good.
Thank you. We have one item remaining on the agenda, but I don't sense that we'll be coming back. It's an executive session item. I don't sense they'll be coming back after the executive session. So I would offer, no, I won't. I'm not going to offer citizens the opportunity to discuss. I will announce upcoming meetings, though. January 15th, 2009 at 8 o'clock a.m. is the Ordinance Committee meeting on the second floor of the Town Hall. Wednesday, January 21st is the forum that Ann mentioned at the beginning of the meeting on the fiscal year 2010 budget, right here in the Council Chambers.
At 7 p.m.
At 7 p.m. January 22nd, we will have a board and commission orientation right here in the council chamber. That will also be at 7 o'clock. January 28th at 7 o'clock, we have a workshop with the school board, tentatively or actually scheduled for the high school cafeteria.
Actually.
Thank you. Thursday.
Excuse me, that's also at 7 p.m.
7 p.m., thank you. Thursday, February 5th, I saw on the meeting agenda, meeting calendar that we have a workshop agenda to be announced. And Monday, February 9th is our next regular town council meeting here in the chambers at 7:30 p.m. Having done that, I would accept a motion. Do we need a motion to adjourn this meeting, or should we?
No, you can't go to
okay.
executive session.
Okay, I would accept a motion to move to executive session. The reason is to enter an executive session in accordance with 1 MRSA Section 405-6A to begin the annual evaluation of the town manager.
Second.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion on the motion? Seeing none, all in favor? We will move to executive session.
Sure.